Aguilera. Oye, mamita,
dale,
que la cosa está rica.
Where did that sound come from? That sound is like the first sound you hear and you recognize it, but you know, you don't know where it's from.
Yeah, it's a sample from, it's an 80s song by Aha, a really famous song called Take On Me, and it has that as like the main hook. It's way faster though, I think it's like did it did it did it. My whole thing is like I like to cater to what artists need, and you know, Pitbull has like a very specific sound that's been around for a while and like he's been very successful with it. So in my, I was choosing my synths, you know, I had to kind of really think about what he has done, what he hasn't done, what would fit the type of song it was. And so I just figured like a simple sawtooth sound, you know, layered with a couple other ones would really kind of impact him. This is actually one of the things that ties it together most, this sound.
I like it because it sounds like really bendy. How did you make that?
Yeah, it's actually just a sound from the Nord lead. It's a weird sound, but it's like, I mess with it quite a lot, put a lot of different EQs and distortions on it and stuff.
Play without it?
And this is with it. It just kind of carries it, you know, gives it that nice bottom, you hear the full chord, yeah. Kind of just ties it all in together.
You know, one of the things that I really liked in the songs that I've heard from you, man, are your breakdowns. What is going on in there, what really adds to the energy of like moving on to the next part.
One of my favorite ones is the one right at the end.
So how did you do that?
So that, I actually just went through one of my samba banks and found, I found this weird like, what kind of sound, like this weird dubstep-y sound. Okay. And I just kind of grabbed it and I stretched it out a little bit and made it fit the meter, and then I just, you know, put a filter on it and automated the filter to kind of go up. So I put a low pass filter on it and automated the highs to come up. And then I pitched it up at the end to be kind of random, nothing like specific. And then I just found these really dope like Nintendo kind of Atari sounds.
Yeah.
To kind of have like this weird full, you know. Social media is such a big deal these days, and if you don't utilize it as a producer, as someone in the entertainment industry, you're kind of blocking yourself off from a huge relationship builder. And I saw that Niall Atway, who's Nasri's brother, he was reaching out to new songwriters and producers asking if, you know, that he was looking for them to help build Nasri's publishing company with Adam. I hope we meet again. You know, I was on Twitter one day and I didn't know, you know, I didn't have a manager, didn't have anyone. And I sent him a link of my music and he didn't actually get back to me. I sent it again. And then he did get back to me and he was like, this is awesome, come through. And he invited me to the studio that day and I played a little piano. I worked on a couple songs and we all got on along really great.
Because not only, you didn't only have this this record with Pitbull, you had another one, right?
I did another one called Hope You Meet Again with Chris Brown. We could be anywhere tonight. Yeah, that was the first one I did, and that one actually led to this one.
But then before that, you did something else.
Yeah, I did with Justin Bieber.
That was the first one, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I did two. I did one featuring Ludacris, which actually just hit radio. It's a new single. The album, I mean, the music video just came out.
Say to like somebody at Berkeley even, or even just a producer that may not have went to Berkeley or music school and wanting to get a hit record, you know, wanting to make that, get a placement, you know, doesn't have their first one yet. What would you say to them, like, about what you've experienced so far?
If I could really give some real advice, it's like two things. Really, there's a difference between like really listening to a record and then hearing a record. Like hearing a record is kind of establishing in your brain that as a producer, like, oh, cool. The record has four chords, I'm bored by that. Oh, it's got these sounds, like cool. And not really like hear, like you're just hearing the record, it's just kind of going in one ear, out the other, and then you're thinking after it, but like cool. Those are simple melodies, those are simple sounds, those are simple drum patterns, like it's compared to some of the music they might have been exposed to, it's pretty simple sounding. And they feel like they can recreate it. and a lot of them don't succeed. Listen to that. Beautiful. It's authentic. You hear that? Oh, put a nice little breakbeat sample over that. And people that really listen to the records and hear, oh, it's arrangement, you know, a lot of it's arrangement, putting things in the right places, certain parts that play, you know. This record doesn't have a lot of parts, it's like a piano, a synth line. Sure, there's layers of them, but it's like a synth line, a piano, a couple underlying chord synths, and then drums. And it's like, that's pretty much it, you know, you gotta allow the vocals to speak. Oh yeah, ask for money and getting advice. Ask for advice, get money twice. That's a point. That's a good lesson for everyone.
Ask for money and get advice. Ask for advice, get money twice. I'm from the dirty, but that Chico nice. Y'all call it a moment, I call it life.